So a warm welcome to all the participants here. And in India, it's like it's the beginning of winter. It's like a little cool and pleasant here. So I would want to welcome you all once again to this presentation on the core topic of innovation through MOOCs under lifelong learning. The UNESCO area of focus here is capacity building. And I, Annapurna Madhuri, on the behalf of my team, would be presenting on the topic, exploring the possibilities of open education resources in improving the effectiveness in higher education and promoting lifelong learning. So my team members are Dr. Gomati Sridhar, Mr. Mahesh Deshmukh, Mr. Vinod, Dr. Deepa Verma, Major Praveen Raj, and myself, Annapurna Madhuri. I'll be presenting the presentation on the behalf of my entire team. So moving ahead, we have the paper here. We would be exploring the possibilities and of OERs in improving the effectiveness in higher education and promoting lifelong learning. And the study attempts to study the research and future possibilities of the MOOCs created as a part of OE for BW mentoring program 2019 and EduScope 2020. So the keywords here are OER, Open Education Resources, MOOC, Massive Open Online Courses, OE for BW, Capacity Building, Learning Environments, Facilitators, Developers, Content Creation, Curation, and Challenges. So let's first understand a small background of the study. So here we have the Massive Open Online Courses. Having its origin in the distance learning, these MOOCs are an enhanced form of the distance learning, and this has been made possible due to the digital advancement and its application in the field of education and learning. So with a major focus on transfer of learning or the information and construction of knowledge through connectivism-led constructivism, MOOCs tend to establish a connection between the facilitator and the learner, and also among the facilitators, despite the geographical distances, the cultural differences, bridging the physical gaps. So MOOCs have been integrated into higher education with lots of variations. One of the most prominent variation being integrating MOOCs with the formal syllabus, but using a flexible instructional strategy involving collaboration, making it more activity-based and reflection-based. So the three possible integration approaches of MOOCs into the mainstream education is: one is integrating MOOCs with the blended learning. Second is integrating MOOCs with the flipped learning. And third is integrating MOOCs in non-formal and informal learning. And this is where we focus on lifelong learning and career professional development programs as well. So that said, the objectives of our study today, we have five main objectives. The first three are related to the developers of MOOCs, and the last two are related to the participants or the beneficiaries of these MOOCs. So the first objective is to study the implications of changing role of educators from being information providers to facilitators of knowledge. The second objective is to assess the involvement of instructors in e-content curation and creation. The third one is to analyze the challenges faced during the deployment and delivery of the MOOCs, these challenges faced by the developers. And we also collected information about how the opinion of the developers on how these challenges could be minimized. The fourth and the fifth objective focus on the point of view of the learners. So we tried to evaluate the learning environments of the participants so that we could reach them better. And the fifth one is to assess the quality and adaptation of OER in the learner perspective, how the learners are using the material which they have got through these open courses, and how beneficial they are and how useful it has been, the material overall has been to the learners. So the data has been collected from the developers of the OE4BW projects from last 3 years, and we received 22 responses. 20 responses are from India. The participants of the courses of these 22 developers also were provided with a survey form, and we collected the data from 126 learners, that is the participants of these courses. The tool we used for the survey, we had two separate questionnaires for the developers as well as the participants. So for the survey form for the developers had 38 items focusing on the role of the developers as facilitators, their involvement in developing and deploying the courses, focusing on developing the open education resources and the challenges they faced. The survey form for the participants had 19 items in it, which focused on their learning environments, the quality and adaptation of the open education resources in all these MOOCs. So that said, the objective one, so before I begin explaining the objectives, I would want to make this disclaimer, say, keeping in view the given time and also considering the overall sentiment of the survey, I would be focusing on only the crucial points of survey. Though we had a lot many points, and of the 38 plus 19 items, I wouldn't be discussing all of them, but I would be just focusing on the main points. So here we have the objective one, change in the role of educator. So we talked to the educators about the difference they observed in their expertise as developers, whether they required formal training or not, how comfortable are they with collaboration and co-creation of MOOCs, what would be the best mode of offering the course, whether it is synchronous or asynchronous or a blend of both, what kind of licenses are used to put forward these, to offer this open education resources as well as the open courses, and the interaction with the participants, and how did this change their defined role as a sage on the stage to the guide by the site. So working on developing educational resources has made me, so we asked the developers, how do they feel about their changing role? So we prepared a questionnaire of 8 items, and these 8 items helped us understand how the developers described their changing role from being a teacher to a facilitator. 91% of the developers shared that their journey in developing open educational resources for the MOOCs they offered made them create better activities that were engaging to the learners. 81.8% of them felt that they evolved as better content writers. 72.7% of the developers got an in-depth knowledge of the topic they worked on. So other points which were considered is that they became better researchers, they were able to work on the same topic at different levels, create differentiated assignments and differentiated instruction, define the success criteria for the learners, and all this enabled them to make a smooth transition from the role of sage on the stage to the guide by the site. So 14 out of 22 developers have received formal training for designing a course, while 12 out of the 22 developers had the formal training for developing the e-content for their courses. So coming to the objective two, wherein we talk about the involvement of the instructor in creation and curation of the content, the first and foremost thing comes the promotion and the visibility of the OERs, the types of activities that were designed by the developers, the extra support which the developers provided to the participants and the feedback they provided, and the pilot testing of the MOOC. So coming to the promotion of the MOOCs, the promotion of the courses to increase visibility of the OERs is an integral part of the and important part of deploying the courses. So this is extremely important so that the information reaches the target group, and it also has to reach well within time so that the people can enroll themselves for these courses. So 91.9% of the developers use the social media platforms like Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram handles to promote their courses. 59% use the contacts of their friends, and 50% of them using their primary contacts spread this word. 36.4% developers reach the target clientele through the word of mouth, but only 4.5% of the developers promoted their course approaching the institutions and getting participants to register. So this is the area where we still need a lot of work on. We'd be discussing this more about it. Then the type of activities that were designed. So apart from providing the course content and the information, activity-based learning is a method to ensure the involvement of the learners in the process. So developing topic related to the content is most popular activity given by the 72% of the developers, while 54% of the developers designed reflective-based activities. 50% assigned case studies for making the learners have an in-depth understanding of the concept, while 27% also asked their participants to share their audio visuals. For these audio visuals, related prompts were provided to them. So the other activities involved quiz, hands-on activities, H5P branching scenarios, and Wellmage. Coming to the objective three, we'll be talking about the challenges faced by the developers in development and deployment of the course. The most popular challenge was lack of systematic process and review mechanism, poor infrastructure, and lack of sufficient channels for distribution. Support from the institution is important, and also the time constraints. So I would be focusing only on the top two challenges, where I had 31.8% of the developers had challenges due to lack of systematic process and review mechanism, as well as lack of awareness among the target audiences. 27.3% faced challenges due to poor infrastructure and lack of sufficient channels for distribution. So we also asked them what could be the possible ways to minimize these challenges, where we had 95.45% of the developers saying that common platform for uploading the course material and also for increasing its visibility is a must. We had 90.9% of the developers saying that they need to have a systematic protocol for developing and executing of the courses designed, and this procedure has to be designed and upgraded regularly. And also 90% of the people felt that online training has to be provided with a special emphasis on curation of the content rather than the creation of the content. So coming to the objective four, now let me tell you this objective four and five analyze the participant point of view. So we collected information from the participants to evaluate learning environment of the courses. So we also asked them their purpose and motivation for taking the course. How important is the certification? Were the remainders for the assignments and the assessment submissions helpful to them? And what was the rate of completion of the course? And most importantly, the reason for the dropouts. But here in this presentation, I would be focusing more on the learning environments, the content quality, and the access to the material. So 89.6% of the participants agreed that the courses had been learner-centric, and a learner-centric environment has been created using variety of learning modules in the form of text or the audio visuals, worksheets, quizzes, assignments, reflective tasks, and so on. So this created a connected community and established a supporting learning culture. Regular creative opportunities were provided by the instructors for reflective learning, and also the activities in the course supported learning of the concepts. So they also felt that there were multiple opportunities provided to ask questions, and the questions were weighed more than the answers, and the learning habits were constantly modeled by the instructors. So coming to the objective 5, where we talk about quality and adoption of OER in the learner perspective. We would be talking about the best aspects of the course and the reuse of the material by the learners. So while 63.5% participants felt that easy applicability of the concepts learned was the best part of the course, 62.7% felt that content explanation was the best part. 50% felt that audio visuals created were very, very useful, and 42.1% voted for the text material provided, while 31.7% said that supporting worksheets related to the course had been the best part of the course. So that said, when we asked about rating the items in the way they used the usefulness of the material, we had 72.7% participants who could use the text and the audio visuals directly into their classroom teaching learning process. 83.3% of the respondents, the participants, have recommended the course material to their students and colleagues, while 79.3% adopted the content and reworked on it for their instruction. 58.7% of the participants shared the material with their friends who had not enrolled for the courses, while 85.7% participants would want their friends to take up the course since it adds up value to the class. So that said, the focusing on the results and discussion, formal training to the developers, and before formal training, we need to have a systematic protocol for development and execution of the courses. Formal training to the developers, environment for collaboration, and the licenses. So there was a drastic need felt for a formal training to be given to the developers so as to bring them all on the common platform for developing the open education resources and deploying their courses. Identifying open access content, curating this content for the course, understanding the gaps, and creating material that are unavailable but important for the course with an open license are the areas where the developers might need guidance. Content curation and creation. Though most developers used 40% of the content that is already available, this can be considerably increased so as to make space for to create engaging learning experiences for the learners instead of adding up to the internet clutter of videos and available open access material. Talking about challenges, we could be talking about having a common platform to launch the courses to ensure visibility of the courses, and also having common platforms with a user-friendly interface for both instructor and the learner. And if OERs could be created in multiple languages, MOOCs could automatically become indigenous, thereby making it more learner-centric. Following a systematic protocol of instructional design, design platforms could make the course as well as the content developed more accessible and could reach a larger population. Freedom with some methodology is essential. So allowing for collaboration among the developers, having multiple developers for launching and deploying the course rather than having only one person working on it. So coming to the conclusions, the choice of the course needs to focus on what the learners need. Emphasis needs to be on developing interpersonal skills of the learners and bringing in activity-based assignments, which demands the learners to connect with other learners online or otherwise and collaborate to complete the assignments in the best possible manner. Instructors have to provide a wide scope for interaction and discussion among the learners, providing review and feedback on each other's work. This builds strong interpersonal bonds and eases out the channels for better communication and expanded output. Courses need to be customized on the basis of socio-cultural context, keeping in mind the digital divide, the knowledge gap among the different sections of the society. There is a drastic need to develop need-based specific online courses, making it more indigenous. So indigenous MOOCs, which can later be modified and reused for different scenarios or different sections of the people, keeping the overall structure intact. MOOCs need not be massive, but could be tailor-made as per the need of specific target group, considering the geographical and socio-cultural and the digital accessibility context. So e-content could be created, and it could be utilized to its maximum, and the efforts of the developers need not be undermined or wasted. So most of the times what happens, the developer develops a course and offers it once, and then the course is lost in the large array of the courses. So indigenous MOOCs, iMOOCs, which we term it, might help in increasing the number of people using the online platforms, thereby reducing the digital divide and the knowledge gap, offering out of the box and beyond the textbook learning opportunities. So, thank you so much for the patient listening.
Thank you.